Was your mic on the front? Or are you piped into the sound?
No, we're not. I have another one up there.
Quick announcement before we get started. Just as a reminder, we're going to try to do this twice a year, so hopefully another forum in the fall to update you on progress made and results from the 2011 boating season, typically the summer months. Another one, we wanted to give a thank you to Sierra Pizza, very nearby. To let us maximize our puny food budget and provide you guys
with any clams and
proper snacks.
Sorry.
Pizza with tiny Asian clams. And anyone that is interested in receiving the newsletter to become updated on aquatic invasive species issues, boat inspections, and the like, we do have a sign up sheet out here as well, next to the sign-up sheet for your questions and comments. So, where we
I just want to say something. I realized as after I had done my presentation, I'd be able to recognize an important partner on the coordinating committee. And since he's sitting in the back, I wanted to recognize the Herald-Center of Vermont and the Water Quality Control Board for all their very important contributions to our management team. So I wanted to correct that. Thank you.
We don't want to leave anyone out.
I don't want to leave anyone out.
So speaking of the Watercraft Inspection Program, our next presenter is Kim Kasman from the Tahoe Regional Planning Agency. He will focus on boat inspections.
Yes.
Thank you. It's really a pleasure to be here tonight. Is really the key piece of the prevention program. And really the prevention program itself has two primary objectives. One is to prevent the introduction of new and target invasive species into the basin that we've talked about a lot. The second is actually to prevent the movement of invasive species within the basin. So for example, Lake Tahoe has Asian clam and milfoil that doesn't currently exist in Fallen Leaf Lake or Echo Lake, and we want to prevent that. And so there's really a twofold goal of the Watercraft Inspection Program. The inspection program itself, probably everybody's very familiar with the motorized side of it, but it also encompasses non-motorized vessels as well. And so I'll talk a little bit about that as we go through. In 2010, the Motorized Watercraft Inspection Program launched over 20,000 unique vessels into the lake at various launch facilities. These are check-in of sealed boats that would have already been through the system. We did 7,000, actually almost 8,000, inspections. There are new inspections of either boats that had been here previously and broke their seal, or boats that were new to Tahoe. And of those 8,000, we actually decontaminated about 1,200. And decontaminations were performed because of a variety of reasons, coming from high-risk water bodies. There may have been oil or grease or dirt or other things in the boat itself that presented a concern to our inspectors, and therefore we performed those decontaminations. This past season, we introduced roadside inspection stations. There were four stations located around the basin, and about 30% of the inspections that were performed last year were done at these roadside stations. We also, on the non-motorized side, conducted about 2,800 screenings, and those screenings were done by the U.S. Forest Service and also by a roving inspector that we had at Fallen Leaf Lake. Those inspections and screens actually gave us a lot of very interesting data as it relates to non-motorized watercraft. For example, about 50% of the screenings that were done by the U.S. Forest Service actually identified that boats had been, the non-motorized vessels had come to us from outside of the basin. And over 60% of the vessels, non-motorized vessels that were at Fallen Leaf Lake, were actually found to have launched in another water body other than Fallen Leaf Lake prior to that screening. And so it really helps us understand the scope of what we're dealing with in terms of the movement between lakes within the basin, as well as the movement from outside of the basin. When we talk about the prevention program, we're talking about reducing the risk of establishment of these target invasive species that we've talked about today. If we think about it in terms of the scale, very high risk means that there's essentially perfect conditions. It's basically sure to establish that we would have these species established in the lake, essentially a perfect habitat and perfect vectors. What we found here in Tahoe is that the likelihood of establishment of these species is lower already. In fact, the basis here in Tahoe is essentially a medium, what we would gauge as a medium risk of establishment of these species. But any changes in the physical environment, changes in the vectors, proximity to other water bodies that are infested, as well as things that we can do through the prevention program, can raise that level up and down. And obviously the prevention program is designed to bring that level of risk down. But the important thing to remember is, even as we go and push it down further into this low level of risk, we're never going to approach, there's no such thing as zero risk. And there's no second chance. And so the prevention program is designed to lower that risk as much as possible, but still allow access to the lake and still make it convenient for boaters to go through this prevention program. So what are we talking about when we talk about the inspection program? On the motorized side, we're talking about a physical and a visual inspection of all of the various components that are shown here, including, and it's important to note, including the trailer and anything that touches water. And so when we're looking at the inspection itself, we're actually not just looking at the vessel, we're looking at toys, we're looking at any equipment that has been in the water, the anchor, the lines, all of that information is part of the inspection. We also are asking survey questions and gauging risk and gauging more information from that. But essentially, any vessel that has water, oil, or any other anything else that's found in the boat itself, certainly if we see vegetation, if we see mussels, anything attached to it, we are going to require that boat to be decontaminated. Now, for this coming season, we've actually quadrupled our capacity to perform decontaminations at our stations in Myers and our station in Alpine Meadows. And we've essentially doubled the capacity at all of our other stations to be able to keep up with this increasing load and to be able to provide timely decontaminations. On the non-motorized side, as I mentioned before, it all relates to this clean, drain, dry, and dispose mantra, if you will, that we hear often. And there's, you know, it really does apply to all the various types of non-motorized vessels that touch the water. Again, it's essentially any equipment that is in the water. And, you know, the risks are magnified for non-motorized because of the dispersed use of these vessels, the various places that you can launch, and the portability certainly ups the ante in terms of non-motorized. So how are we addressing this? Well, through outreach, we also have roving inspectors that will be going to common launch sites and doing screenings. And also our partnership, as you know, we've talked about a lot today, partnerships with the Forest Service, with our public and private partners, to be able to screen people where there are kiosks and where we do have that interaction point to be able to perform these screenings for our non-motorized. On the non-motorized side, there's no fee for the inspection services that are provided. There may be in the future, but for this year, there's no fee proposed. On the motorized side, there is a fee. There has been a fee for a couple of years. We're proposing minimal changes to that fee this year. We're actually simplifying it. And the vast majority, as you can see, of the boaters will pay the same or less in most cases. Now, the fees themselves cover approximately 29% of the cost of the motorized inspection program. The remaining funds come from federal sources, federal grants. And that's another thing, as Patrick sort of mentioned as well, that we're relying on those fees right on those federal grants right now to be able to subsidize the fees, but that's not always going to be the case. And so we are looking for alternative funding sources. And just to give some perspective, the fee structure that we're proposing this year will range from $30 to $105, depending on the length of your vessel. If we had to float the entire program based on those fees, they would be somewhere between three and four times that amount, depending on the vessel size. These fees also apply to the Lake Tahoe program. We are working with the lake managers of other water bodies in the region, but because of the fact that some waters don't have invasive species that we do have in Tahoe, changes in protocol and other things like that, the fees, those lakes essentially have their own programs. And so we do share resources, information, all of that, but the programs themselves are separate. So this fee is specific to Tahoe. In terms of what you get for that fee, basically the motorized fee this year will cover the AIS inspection, the collection of vessel data, as well as the services of sealing and unsealing vessels at the ramps. We also have, as I said, the fee will be based on length. And what we've done this year is essentially we're driving all of those full AIS inspections and decontaminations to our highway stations. Boats that are currently sealed will be able to go to the launch facility of their choice and be able to launch. All other boats will have to go to the roadside stations. Where are the roadside stations? There are six that we are locating. I know this map is incredibly hard to see. There's a copy of it in the back of the room. And for those that want to go launch, this is where you can go to do that. Thanks.
Thank you, Ken. Reminder, you guys, I'm sure there's lots of questions about the boat inspection program, so we'll send that outside. Real Ken later.
Mentioned on that last slide. We also, if people do have boats, on the TahoeBoatInspections.com site, we have a link. You can sign up to be a secret shopper and help us evaluate the effectiveness of our program. We are looking for people to sign up for that. You may get your inspection reimbursed.